ازيكم يا شباب؟ معاكم سيف عبد الرحمن وكريس من ايفون فيتنس بقى دلوقتي. وطبعا صباح الفل او مساء الفل على حسب انتوا بتشوفوا الفيديو ده امتى. واهلا بيكم في فيديو جديد. والمره دي يا كابتن عبد الرحمن عندنا ايه؟
عندنا كيو ان ايه.
عندنا كيو ان ايه، يعني عندنا سؤال وجواب، والشباب كلها سالت اسئله واحنا هنسال الراجل ده شويه اسئله كده من اللي سالت الاسئله الحلوه، الاسئله المحترمه، مش اي سؤال وخلاص، مش حاجه ليها علاقه بالبروتين الخام.
اه بالظبط.
فهنسال الراجل اسئله، وطبعا هو هيقول بالانجلش بس هتلاقوا طبعا الترجمه موجوده تحت عشان نسيف وقت، وعشان طبعا الفيديو ما يبقاش ساعه ونص ساعتين. فهنختار كده شويه اسئله حلوه ويلا بينا. اول سؤال بيقول ايه راي كريستوفر في الاي اي اف واي ام؟ سو كريس، بيسكلي سينس وي دوينج ذس، وات دو يو ثينك اباوت ذا اف ات فيتس يور ماكروز بروتوكول؟
شور. سو essentially, if it fits your macros is a good starting point, but it doesn't cover all of your bases. So if you understand like the foundational principles of nutrition, we know that calories are most important, the macronutrients are right above that, and we know that not all calories are created equal. So tracking your macronutrients is super important, but if you don't pay attention to your nutrient density, your micronutrients, your nutrient timing, you're not optimizing everything if you're just focusing on macros alone. So
but like, what would you say it like for the general population? Is it like, is it a good way to get started? Then you can be more
specific,
like more like you can optimize as you go.
Sure, yeah, you should track your macronutrients whether you're a general pop or an advanced person. But you need to understand that there are some other things you need to take into consideration besides just macronutrients. So some people get a little bit too carried away and their entire diet will be all processed food and they say, oh, it doesn't matter because I'm hitting my macros. That's not necessarily true.
Okay.
So there needs to be an appropriate balance between it. But everyone should track their macros if they have a very specific, you know, physique goal. It's the best way to control body composition.
Okay.
That makes sense. So yeah, like basically what we do, like we recommend like having like at least 70 to 75% of your food choice, like
from whole food.
Yeah, from whole food, like food that has like pretty good nutritional density and stuff. And like if you want to go out like 2 to 3 days a week, you can actually do that, especially 100%. Post your workout, because your pre-workout nutrition is pretty much essential basically. So
yeah,
that's what we do. So you actually would recommend IFOM, and if it's actually more focused on nutritional density, basically.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I track my numbers, and then I still eat out frequently. My clients eat out frequently because they have a basis of tracking. I think one of the best things you can do is track diligently for 3 months or more and learn that skill, and then you can be more flexible over time. But tracking is a great way to understand portion size is much better and get a better understanding of how much you should be eating of what types of food. So it's essential to start with like being very on point with if it fits your macros. Just don't get carried away and eat nothing but junk food and not eat your whole food. That's all.
Cool.
Yeah.
طيب تاني سؤال عندنا، في حد بيسأل هو انا ازاي اقدر اعرف ان انا بعمل progressive overload، وهل في علاقة يعني لازم يبقى فيه muscle soreness او شد عضلي بعد ما انت تتمرن، وهل ده ليه، هل ده دليل يخليك تعرف ان انت بتعمل progressive overload بشكل صح؟ So the guy is asking is how to know that you are doing progressive overload, and is there a relationship between progressive overload and muscle soreness?
Yeah, so there isn't a relationship between progressive overload and muscle soreness. So you can get stronger, you know, week to week or month to month, depending on your level of advancement, without getting terribly sore. One thing I will say for naturals, if you're doing too much volume and you're getting too sore, I personally believe now you're hindering your ability to progress and grow, because your muscle protein breakdown is higher than your muscle protein synthesis. So it's like you're digging a bigger ditch than you can refill. And if you're doing that, you're gonna be spinning your wheels. So you wanna make sure the intensity is high in the gym, but you're not doing too much total work where you're so sore and you're under recovered. If you're under recovered, you're not gonna grow. if you're not growing, getting stronger is going to be really difficult.
Yeah, that makes sense.
ده ثالث سؤال وهو سؤال وناس كتير بتساله لنا كمان. الراجل بقى يرد عليه بصراحه. ازاي تقدر تتجاوز البلاتو او لو وزنك ثابت؟ So the question is how to overcome weight loss plateau.
Weight loss plateau is cool. So one thing I highly recommend if you have hit a weight loss plateau is to take a diet break. So that can be as short as 3 to 5 days or as long as like 2 weeks off where you're kind of eating at theoretical maintenance. The goal is no longer being in a deficit. You're taking a lot of stress off of your body, like physiologically and mentally. And a lot of times that can also upregulate your hormones like T3, T4, your thyroid and leptin. And then if you kind of get that back to normal, you go back into a deficit and you kind of make progress right away.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Take a diet break if you need to.
Diet break is really, I mean, subhanallah.
نقول نفس الكلام.
Subhanallah.
Yeah.
So, I know this is a pretty common question as well. في حد بيسأل, يعني الناس كتير بتسأل السؤال ده على طول. إزاي تقدر إن أنت تحدد سعرات الثبات بتاعتك؟ So they're like, how would you figure out the maintenance calories of a client, or how can someone figure it out for themselves?
For themselves. So. The way I would figure it out for a client is I use certain formulas that will at least guesstimate me within a reasonable range. And again, this kind of works for like 65% of the population really well.
Yeah.
That normal distribution thing we spoke about the other time. But if the formulas don't really apply to the specific client well, because they're an outlier, you just have them track their body weight every single day. So you get their 7-day average. And then you also have them on very specific macronutrients and calories.
Yeah.
If they're losing weight, they're clearly in a deficit. If they're gaining weight, they're in surplus. If their 7-day average is staying very, very similar, you know that you found your caloric maintenance.
يعني من الآخر زي ما احنا بنقول تجرب. So like trial and error is the, like seeing what your body tells you is the way to go. Like there is no like specific formula, there is no like there isn't the best formula.
Yeah.
Like what if their weight is actually what if their weight is actually the same?
Yeah.
But they're actually recomping. Like they could be losing fat and gaining muscle.
Sure.
Also like how do they know that they are recomping and this isn't their maintenance?
Exactly.
Okay. That's a good question. And then just one thing I'll say is like it's basically guess and check. Like it's a very easy way to go about it. But a way that you would know that you're recomping, even if your scale weight's staying the same, is by utilizing other measurements besides your body weight. So taking like a waist circumference measurement or taking a skin fold thickness measurement, that's a really good way to see if you're gaining fat or losing fat.
Yeah.
So if your waist circumference is going down, but your body weight's staying the same, it's a good sign that you're probably losing some fat and gaining a little bit of muscle.
That makes sense.
So take progress photos too and like standardize lighting so you can put a picture side by side and see like, okay, I look better here even though my weight's the same.
Okay,
perfect, that makes sense. طيب السؤال اللي جاي يا شباب وهو سؤال بيسأل كتير ده بقى سؤال عايزين نعرف رد الراجل فيه. So the question is, do you think binge eating is a mental thing or there's a physical solution to avoid it?
It's a little bit of both. So I think over time, as you gain experience with dieting, you also kind of strengthen your self-discipline. Like we talk about progressive overload at the gym or strengthening our muscle.
Also happens mentally.
Over time, you kind of train your mind to just have better control, better self-discipline. For beginners and intermediates, it's really common that when they're dieting down, their relationship with food gets a little bit worse, kind of gets worse. And then when their diet is over, they're at a much higher likelihood of binging. But over time, you kind of just regain control of the physical and the mental stuff. What I will say physically, there are some things that work against you, like some of your hormones become elevated that increase your hunger. So something like ghrelin can be elevated and it's not just the mental thing. It's like physically, you're actually really hungry and your body's telling you like, I need food. So it's hard to fight that urge.
Yeah.
But over time, these things change.
Yeah, so you basically adapt in time. And like, you're mentally, you're even more stoic, basically.
For sure.
Yeah, perfect. That makes sense.
Cool.
Yeah. And actually, a couple of people are asking, are you having a course or a book that speaks about contest prep and peak week.
About peak week. Oh boy. Yeah, stay tuned.
Stay tuned. See no evil, speak no evil.
Yeah, hopefully by the end of this year or the very beginning of next year, you guys get what you're asking for.
Yeah. And you get what you pay for, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so let's go for this question. So someone is asking, how would you know that this volume is right for you, or whether is or whether the volume is good, your intensity is good? Like, how would you figure out what's wrong with your training? So sure. A lot of people be like, am I doing enough volume, or is my intensity shit?
Sure.
Should I increase my sets, or should I lower them and increase the intensity? So like, how do they find the sweet spot of volume, intensity, and frequency?
Sure. So if you're not progressing, something's wrong, and that's when you need to address one or multiple of those variables. If you're making progress from week to week or month to month, you're probably in a decent place. It doesn't mean you can't make things better. Mm-hmm. But if you're spinning your wheels, something's going wrong. Personally, I think people do too much overall volume and not enough appropriate intensity, so not high enough intensity. So the thing is, let's just say you're in the gym for 2 hours a session, you might be able to get better results in 75 minutes by doing less working sets, so less total volume, but higher intensity.
So what you mean by intensity is going to failure.
Closer to failure.
Close to failure. Yeah. The closer, the better, basically.
Yeah.
The other thing is, why is Grom taking 250 grams protein? So the question is, like, since I'm, like, Abdurrahman and I were having about 230, 240 grams of protein, people are asking, why is Big Ramy only having 250 grams of protein in it?
Interesting. Yeah. Well, personally, maybe he's eating closer to 300. I'm going to assume he's eating closer to 300.
Yeah.
But secondly, obviously the anabolics are a huge component. He would make progress whether he ate 200 or 300. It's not going to matter that much. The reason I like protein so much is because it's one of those macronutrients that a lot of the research shows you can overeat protein, and unlike the other calories from fats and carbohydrates, the likelihood of it being stored as fat is basically slim to none.
Okay.
And because it has such a thermic effect, it increases your caloric expenditure, right? The components of caloric expenditure are your basal metabolic rate, the non-exercise activity thermogenesis, so walking around, any sort of movement you do, obviously your exercise, and then the thermic effect of food. So the foods you're eating. So like, if I ate a 2000 calorie diet and Saif ate a 2000 calorie diet, but Saif's eating 120 grams of protein and I'm eating 200 grams of protein, our caloric intake is 2000 calories.
But the composition would be different.
But my caloric expenditure is higher because my protein intake is higher, so my thermic effect of food is higher. So it's way better for body composition.
And that's why it's lean not only on the about calories, stuff. Basically.
It's not only
it's not
about
only
calories.
Having 2,000 calories and that's it.
Exactly. Right. Otherwise, we would get shredded doing like Weight Watchers or Jenny Craig.
Yeah.
And nobody does that.
Yeah.
You know? So a lot of people say, wow, your protein is really high.
Yeah. We get that a lot.
Like, we get that a lot.
I get that a decent amount too.
So I'll be like, Eli Khali. كوتش كويس او ايه اللي يخليك تقول على نفسك ان انت كوتش كويس. So this question is, and I'm gonna like add a bit to it.
Yeah.
Why do you think, like, I'm gonna ask it to you personally, why do you think you are a good coach, and what do you think a good coach should be?
Sure. So first and foremost, like, I genuinely care about the clients getting good results. I think that's the primary foundational thing. Second of all, the results over the last 7 years kind of speak for themselves. I have a lot of experience, and then like, I've walked the process myself. I've done lean gaining phases and bulks, I've done contest preps and gotten shredded, so I have the experience. And then I've walked people of all different kind of walks of life through it. So
yeah.
A 40-year-old female that started off at 30% body fat, you know, I've worked with every kind of client you can work with. So I have the experience.
A large pool of clients, basically.
Large pool of clients. I don't think you need to have the highest level of education by any means. It's a lot of people, I think education formally can be overrated. And the reason I say that is because there are people I graduated with that have a master's degree that I would never want a family member of mine to like be coached by them. Mm. You know what I'm saying? And then I have friends that don't have the formal education that I know they do wonderful work with their clients and they're good coaches. So education formally isn't that important, but you need to be passionate about what you're doing. So you're constantly self-educating yourself and you need to care about their results.
That's super important. That's something that, because like we had a video like saying the same, like explaining that to know a good coach, like it's all about education, experience and ethics.
Yeah,
like you need to combine the three. Like it could be, you could have all the certificates in the world, but he has no experience.
Sure.
And like he could have experience, but like his work is done based on experience, but it's not based on science.
Sure.
And he could have both, but he doesn't care about his clients or whatever.
Sure, 100%.
So do you think evolve? They're good coaches.
You guys are nailing it, man. Well, I saw your clients in the gym yesterday. Yeah. And they're shredded and they're ready. And I've seen the results you produce, so you guys are doing great work, man.
Appreciate it. Okay, so this is a question. And like people still ask the same question over and over again. If you're in a calorie deficit and you have a dessert, are you gonna get fat?
Absolutely not. So the same way eating one salad isn't gonna get you shredded, having one dessert isn't gonna make you fat. And that's something that really kind of stands out to me, like while I'm peaking athletes, because there's days where I'm giving them like 700 carbs, 800 carbs, and their calories are so high. When your body's depleted, if you've been dieting for a while and a deficit for a while, the calories you eat, they're not going to go to fat storage right away. They're actually going to go to glycogen storage first because you're flat. So you kind of have this buffer and this safety.
Mm.
Where like actually no, like your body's gonna utilize that and store that as energy, as carbohydrate energy, not as triglyceride fat energy. So you're in the safe zone. And I would kind of recommend that you practice that flexibility and you're not scared to, you know, have a dessert and kind of fit that into your calories. I remember one thing I'll share, like just a couple months ago, we were watching the Olympia.
Yeah.
And I was 2 weeks out from one of my shows, and my brother was at my house with a bunch of my friends who are in the bodybuilding space.
Okay.
And that night, I ate like low-fat, low-calorie ice cream, and I ate a lot of it. Yeah. And my brother was shocked. He's like, I can't believe you're eating this 2 weeks out.
Yeah.
And then the next day, I hit a new low. Like, yeah. It was my lowest weight. I'm like, yeah, I fit it into my calories.
Oh.
So yeah. That is a question, and this is... Bro, people treat insulin like it's the devil's work.
Yeah.
So, فالناس كلها بتتكلم على الانسولين. لو كلت كارب هيعلي الانسولين. ما ينفعش الانسولين بتاعك يا لا ما مقاومة الانسولين حساسية الانسولين. فأنا هسأله بقى كل حاجة عن الانسولين عشان الناس تبقى عارفة ان الموضوع ده أوله وآخره إيه. So people are like, if I shouldn't be eating carbs because they raise insulin. Or like you shouldn't eat something that contains sugars because it raises insulin, and insulin is like this devil hormone that only does with shoving. It's only shoving fat to the fat cells, and like you should always make sure that your insulin is down. Sure. It shouldn't be elevated whatsoever. So what's your take on this? Yeah. Because a lot of people. Like they devilize insulin so much,
yeah.
But they don't know that insulin has like the anabolic side of it.
For sure. Yeah, it's completely false.
And also, let me combine this one as well. What do you think about the insulin sensitivity and insulin resistance? Is it a thing?
Yeah.
Do people have it or do people exaggerate it as well?
Sure. So,
like insulin.
For sure. First of all, it's just. Yeah, overhyped and a lot of it's falsified. So like we just had whey protein shakes post-workout. That whey protein, even though there's no carb in it, spiked insulin to the same degree as me eating 30 grams of sugar. You know, so your protein sources are extremely insulinogenic as well, especially if you're from an animal source. So even like a chicken breast, very insulinogenic. So you're spiking insulin all day long, whether you want it or not, because insulin is really important for nutrient delivery, not just fat storage. So if you want to deliver amino acids into a muscle cell or if you want to deliver glucose into a muscle cell, you need insulin there. So yeah, it's very, like you used the term devilized, it's totally unnecessary.
Yeah.
Now, is insulin resistance a real thing? Yeah, but that's...
But also like, can you be lean and insulin resistance at the same time?
Not really.
So okay, so...
Yeah. Unless you have like a genetic disorder, you're not gonna be like healthy and lean and insulin resistant. So you can check your fasting blood glucose levels. If you're not pre-diabetic, so if your fasting blood glucose levels are below 100, you have nothing to really stress about. You would want to be, you know, in that sweet spot of like 75 and 90. But again, people just over worry about this. If you're not pre-diabetic or a type 2 diabetic or a type 1 diabetic, you don't have to be worrying about this. If you don't respond great to carbohydrate, you can focus on putting the majority of your carbs pre-workout and post-workout. And then the rest of your meals can be like higher in fat, vegetables, and protein. So you can get into nutrient timing strategies.
Yeah.
But people overstress about it.
But something I want to make sure people get it. So if you are on a ketogenic diet, your insulin is not suppressed.
No, it's not.
No.
Yeah.
يعني انت حتى لو بتاكل بروتين ودهون بس الانسولين بتاعك
هيعلى برضه هيعلى فما فيهاش كلام.
And also people like here be like there'll be high protein, high fat.
Yeah.
So point. With the high protein, some of it gets converted to glucose.
Yeah.
Yeah.
فأصلا معظم الناس حتى مش بتعمل كيتو بجد. So like a true keto is like moderate protein.
Sure. Moderate protein.
Yeah. So anytime you eat those animal proteins that have those amino acids, which all of them do, like branched chain amino acids, leucine, isoleucine, valine, very insulinogenic. So yeah, you're not suppressing insulin all day long. If you're on a ketogenic diet, your growth hormone isn't going to be significantly elevated to a larger degree than someone else who's eating a well-balanced diet. So again, focus on total calorie intake first, your macronutrient intake second, and then the finer things after that, nutrient timing and so on and so forth. But yeah, if we went keto, like you're on a 2000 calorie keto diet, I'm on a 2000 calorie well-balanced diet, we're gonna be getting the same results. Yeah,
but I'm gonna be flat as hell.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
And your food sources are limited, so your ability to sustain the diet is gonna be lower.
Yeah,
right?
That makes sense.
Your enjoyment of that is probably much lower.
Yeah. So it's basically adherence.
Yeah. Adherence. I literally only recommend keto to type 1 diabetics.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's debatable.
تقولها لأي حد بيتمرن طبيعي عشان يقدر فعلا إن هو يوصل للهدف بتاعه. So the question is, give one golden nugget to every natural athlete that they can like take so they can basically like reach their goal or achieve their goals.
I'm gonna keep it simple.
Yeah,
exactly.
First and foremost, practice patience. This stuff takes a long time. So if you've been doing it for, you know, 1 to 3 years, you're not gonna look like someone who's been doing it for 10 years. It just doesn't work that way. Second of all, always focus on learning more and improving your skill set. I think a lot of people's training execution can always get better. So it's like the best basketball players in the world, right? They still shoot free throws every day.
Okay.
Why do they shoot free throws every day, right? Like they're the best. Why do they waste their time on the fundamentals? You need to focus on the fundamentals. So for a bodybuilder, that's like just because you've been benching for 1 year or 3 years, doesn't mean you can't make your bench press better.
Exactly.
Right, doesn't mean you can't make your lat pull down better.
Bro, like we've discovered that we've been doing low rows wrong for like 5 years.
I wouldn't actually say wrong, but not fully optimized.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's always room for improvement.
There's always room for improvement.
And patience.
Practice patience. Takes a long
patience
time.
Patience is key.
Yeah.
Basically. That's what we keep saying to every like natural athlete, like don't compare yourself to like people that have been taking steroids or like their own gear and everything, and like just focus on you basically.
For sure.
Yeah.
Be the best version of yourself. Keep focusing on like your own personal progress.
And enjoy the journey basically.
Yeah. 100%.
ايه الفرق ما بين ازاي اعرف الفرق ما بين ان انا جسمي حابس ميه وان انا عندي دهون. So how do I know that I'm retaining water or that I have more fat to lose?
If you're super like you're already lean.
No, some people be like I'm retaining water while they're like 15%.
Literally like they're 13% and they're like, I just need to get rid of the extra water and I'm gonna be Gucci.
Sure. Yeah. Most of you just have to lose a lot more fat. One thing I will say is like, a lot of people wake up crispier in the morning. You look a little bit leaner in the morning. You're also like mildly dehydrated first thing in the morning, but you can look a little bit crispier and tighter. If 8 hours go by or 10 hours go by, you eat a bunch of food, you're very well hydrated, and you look a little bit blurrier in the evening, yeah, you can say I'm holding some water now, like acutely. But if you never look lean, you have more fat to lose.
Like basically, water retention is temporary, like true water retention.
Very
you cannot
true.
Be like retaining water retaining for 8 weeks for like straight. Now.
Yeah,
it's fat, bro.
Sure. Basically.
Sure, unless you have like a systemic autoimmune disease.
No, no, just a regular dude.
I have a question. وده برضه ناس كتير بيسألوا. Like, people keep attacking us on that. So, since we're having like, we recommend that you have like a decent amount of protein, people still insist that BCAA supplements are important. And we're like, if you're having an adequate amount of protein, you don't need to supplement with BCAAs.
Yeah.
Especially when we are on like, 200 to 230
grams. Yeah. Biggest waste of money. I haven't taken BCAAs since like 2013 because I didn't know better back then. But yeah, essentially BCAAs, I'll use an analogy that they might love. BCAAs initiate muscle protein synthesis. They start that process. So you can think of it of like turning your car key.
Okay.
Turning on the car.
Just that.
Just turning it on. But if you don't have all 9 essential amino acids, you can't keep muscle protein synthesis going. So it's like you can't keep the car on without gasoline.
So like would you recommend an EAA?
EAA
essential amino
acids? Not if you're eating 200 grams. You know, if your protein intake is high, absolutely not. But it's really a waste of money and it could actually be negative because if you turn on that car and there's no gasoline there because you don't have essential amino acids, there's a chance that your body breaks down your own amino acids to utilize that to fuel the process. So now you're really spinning your wheels even
more. So like a spin-off question of this.
Yeah.
So taking BCAAs while training fasted.
Yeah.
Is this like a combination of disasters?
Yeah, and especially it's funny because the people who will take BCAAs while training fasted are also the same people that are worried about insulin.
Yeah.
So they spike their insulin from the BCAA. And they're training fasted, but the insulin is suppressing growth hormone. So they're training fasted for no reason. Their insulin got spiked.
And there is no nutrients to go inside them.
Yeah, it's a disaster.
لو انت نزلت وسبت الباب مفتوح وبس.
Yeah, big disaster.
حد بيسأل هو انت فكرت قبل كده تاخد steroids ومين الشخص اللي ممكن ياخد steroids وامتى تاخدها امتى تستيب ان في ال So the question is, have you personally considered taking gear? And also, when do you think is it a right decision, for someone to go to the enhanced part of the sport? And what is your personal take about it?
Sure. So I personally haven't ever seriously considered taking gear. The first bodybuilding show I ever went to was in 2010.
Okay.
And I was blown away with the physiques I saw. Interestingly, if I saw those same physiques now, I wouldn't be impressed. Because it was a beginner show, it was a local show, but I didn't know anything about the sport of natural bodybuilding.
Were they naturally? So
they were natural. It was a natural show. When I used to think of bodybuilding, I would think of the IFBB and like seeing Kai Greene on the magazines and Jay Cutler.
So all the elites basically.
Yeah, all the elites. And I didn't even know that natural bodybuilding was a thing. The first show I ever went to, I was super, super impressed. And I was doubting whether they were natural or not.
So you got hooked basically in the natural route.
Yeah, I was very impressed. And like, again, now if I look back on it, I wouldn't even consider those physiques impressive. And I would understand, oh, that's an amateur level, novice level bodybuilding show, but it was inspiring. And then I always wanted to see like, what am I capable of naturally without taking anything?
Yeah.
Something that's also inspiring to me about natural bodybuilding is the best people in the sport competitively are between the ages of like 35 and 48, 32 and 48. So like, it's a long man sport.
Yeah.
So that kind of inspires me. We're like, okay, I'm 30 years old in a couple of weeks.
And I'm far away from
my
best.
And I'm far away from my best.
I gotta look like 5 years from now.
Exactly.
Basically. Okay, so you basically, you can keep progressing over and over, like every single year, even if you've been like training for like 10 years, like year 14, you're still gonna like look different.
Year 20.
You're not gonna plateau like in terms of gaining muscle or whatever.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, the rate of progress slows down, but the look just becomes better and better anyway. And once you've been in it for so long, like it's part of your lifestyle, something that you love. So yeah, to answer the second part of your question,
like,
who should consider it?
Who should consider it and why would they? Like,
sure.
What are the right reasons to hop on here?
Yeah. So I don't have an issue at all. It's a personal decision.
We're not talking about this.
No, I agree. I think the only time I think it's worth it to even consider it, if you can make a career out of enhanced bodybuilding.
Like, it's not if you want to, is it if you can?
If you can.
Like, if you have the genetics.
Yeah.
But it's not like, I want to be an IBB pro, I don't have the genetics.
No, it's not worth it. It's terrible for your health.
Yeah.
And like, you can do all of these things and never reach that level anyway.
Yeah.
One of my friends made a great post. He turned pro naturally at 21. Very early, right? So he's like, okay, at least he did attain an amazing physique as a 21-year-old. Crazy. He was beating 35-year-olds and 40-year-olds. He started taking gear very young. He's been competing for maybe 8 years on the enhanced side. He still hasn't turned pro in the IFBB. He's taking everything under the sun. He's worked with the best coaches. And he finally said, I'm retiring from bodybuilding.
He doesn't have the genetics for it.
Yeah, it's negatively impacting his health. And he made a great point. Let's just say you played soccer.
Yeah.
If you're good enough to play in high school, you play high school.
Yeah.
If you're good enough to play college, you play college. If you're good enough to play pro, you play pro. If you're not good enough, you're not good enough.
Yeah.
The problem with bodybuilding, he said, you pay to play. So as long as you keep paying and doing shows, you can keep competing, but like you'll never get to that level if it's not in your cards.
Yeah,
if we're not LeBron James or Ronaldo or whatever, if we're not these elite people, there's no amount of gear that we can take that's gonna change that.
That's gonna change it.
But like, if someone has the genetics, let's say, would you like put a minimum of some years of training naturally?
100%.
Like what, how many years would you say? Like generally speaking.
Generally speaking, at least 6 good years.
Like 6 good?
Good years.
Like not just from the first day you picked up a dumb.
For sure. So like
6 good consistent with good nutrition, good.
Yeah. So like let's just say you started taking it seriously at 18 and you put 6 honest years of work and you look amazing as a 24-year-old and you're more interested on that side, then maybe it's for you. But it's like a big decision because once you make that decision, you kind of can't
go back. You can never go back.
Yeah, that's it. That's it, man.
So let's say you want to get enhanced. Who should you be looking for? What should you be looking for in a coach on the enhanced side as well?
Yeah, I honestly don't know too much about that.
Cool.
And like some of the best coaches in the sport, I know them personally on the enhanced side, but I've also heard that some of their athletes take very high doses of stuff. So it's like a risk reward ratio. And
you
it's
gotta
like,
do your research.
You gotta do your research for sure. Rather than talking to the coaches directly, message their former clients.
Yeah.
How long did you work with this guy for? Why did you stop working with them? Do you recommend working with them?
This is a pretty good
message your former clients.
Here's something as well, like you just said, like you might consider this if you have like 6 years under your belt of training.
Yeah.
But like I believe that it's not only about having like a good base of muscle, but it's also like you mentally know that let's say you want to lose more weight. You won't have to like bump the dose or whatever, but you still know that you still gotta like be in a calorie deficit. You have your macros all set. You have your intensity close to failure and everything. So that like boils down to also knowing the kind of coach that you're going to train with. As
sure.
Well.
Like it's not just I have more fat. T3 goes up.
Yeah.
T3. So
no,
he
no.
could be like, okay, we're gonna do more cardio, so you're in a better deficit.
Sure.
Basically.
Yeah. It's important to understand the training and the nutrition variables.
Yeah.
That's really the foundation of everything. when you go enhanced, that's a whole other level.
Yeah.
But like, that shouldn't be your primary dial that you're changing. Yeah.
So a coach needs not only to be good with the drugs.
Yeah.
But also with training.
With training and nutrition.
Most coaches aren't good with drugs. It's that simple. Like, you know how we were talking about guess and check before?
It's the same.
It's unfortunate that like, they do guess and check on someone else's body. Mm-hmm. Like, take this and see how it goes. Like, it could go really bad, you know?
Try this but you're, a couple of hours later.
You're basically a lab rat, you know?
So this is with everyone, even people on the higher levels of coaching. Like, maybe they're good at it because they've tried it on multiple people.
They have a lot of experience, so they...
They experienced...
Their chance of missing is much smaller, but it's still
it's
not like...
because of experience, because not of experience, because of science.
It's not because of science. It's not. No, it's because of experience.
Yeah. يعني بقول لك انت حفر تجارب واللي هيبقى فاهم هيبقى جرب على كتير قبليك. يعني مش عشان هو فاهم.
ممكن تلاقي حد. ممكن. بس انت بقى تدور بقى على ناس كتير وتشوف وتعمل وعلى الله.
So, when I first started bodybuilding, like, my acute goal was just be the best version of myself. It wasn't win the show. It was not embarrass myself at the show. That's what I was genuinely worried about. I'm gonna do a show and I'm gonna not fit in and like not do well competitively. That was my fear. It wasn't like, oh, I'm gonna do the show and I'm gonna win the show. So what happened was I did my first show and I won my first show. And I was like, oh shit, my confidence went from low to high, right? And then I kind of kept building on it. And then I'm like, okay, maybe I can win an open category. Maybe, right? Then I did that. And I'm like, oh, okay, I guess I could win at this level. So over time it climbed. And then for many, many years, for 8.5 years, I tried turning pro. And I always thought I had what it takes to turn pro, but I never thought in the past that I could be a good pro.
Yeah.
Now, once I reach that level, I'm like, fuck it, I am gonna be a good pro. Like, my goal is to be top three at Worlds my first time ever doing it, and then maybe one day winning my weight class at Worlds. So like, I'm seeing like self-belief increase over time. And the point I wanna make is, it doesn't matter if the people around you believe in you or don't believe in you. It only matters if you believe in yourself. It helps when people around you believe in you because it's encouraging and it's supportive, but you don't necessarily need that. And then at the same time, if people are doubting you and putting you down and telling you you can't do it, that doesn't matter at all either, as long as you believe that you can do it. You know what I'm saying? That's really what it comes down to.
Yeah, like, it's a funny saying, because like, they keep telling you, like, if you're an entrepreneur, if you're a businessman and you need motivation from people, then you should like close your business, basically.
Sure. Yeah. So you need to walk the walk. Thing. Yeah. Like, it's your trenches to do the work. You need to put in the work. It can be lonely at times. Can be lonely a lot of times. But it's something that pays off and you learn from and you grow from. And that's the best part about it. It's not just building the body, it's building the mind. And it's not about... It's about self-growth everywhere. It's not like... Like, I like wearing hoodies and staying covered up so people don't just see, oh, he has some muscle. Like, it's not just about building the muscle, it's about like building the mind. So yeah, I hope you guys stay on your journey, stay on your path, whether people are supporting you or kind of putting you down and hating on you. As long as you're getting better every day and you're putting in honest work, you're gonna progress. So stay the path, stay tough mentally, and you know, 5 years from now, you'll look back at where you started and say, damn, I made a lot of progress. 10 years from now, you'll be blown away. So just stay the path, man.
بس كده يا جماعة، يا رب يكون الفيديو ده عجبكم، وما تنسوش هنحط الانستجرام بتاع كريس، وأول ما ينزل الكورس بتاع البيك ويك هنقول لكم على طول، وهنقول لكم عندنا على انستجرام. من الآخر، احنا بنلبس الراجل على الكاميرا علشان هو محتاج يعمل حاجة زي كده، فاهم؟
ما يدلعش.
اتأكدوا بس. اتأكدوا بس ان انتوا بتعملوا لايك وبتسيبوا لنا كومنت تحت لو عجبكم الفيديو، ولو انت أول مرة تشوف الفيديوهات بتاعتنا اعمل لنا سبسكرايب. سو يا، بس كده، نشوفكم في الفيديو الجاي. كان معاكم عبد الرحمن، كريس، وسيف الضوي. يلا بينا، باي باي.